and today I am going to discuss about the ACL injury, and in which I am going to tell about highlighted on a points which are being an assessment and differential diagnosis. So let's see how we do so. So first we will go with the part of assessment, in which first point has to be the patient history. So it is a very important element in entire treatment. So it's very important to take a patient history. Now under the patient history, the first question which is being asked, that is how injury is being occurred and how it was happened, or what was the mechanism of injury. So the primary mechanism of injury in the knee are valgus forces with or without rotation, the hyperextension flexion with posterior translation and varus force. The first often result in injury to be the medial collateral ligament. Frequently it is accompanied with injury to the posterior mediocapsule, medial meniscus and anterior cruciate ligament, which is called as terrible triad, because three elements are being injured in this. Next, the second leads to anterior cruciate injuries, often associated with meniscus tear. The third mechanism of injury often involves the posterior cruciate ligament, and the fourth mechanism involves the lateral collateral ligament. The posterior collateral capsule and the posterior cruciate ligament are the involved element. And then was the injury the result of trauma, such as the patient is being hit with direct or indirect blow. Was the patient bearing weight at the time of injury? From which direction did the injury force came? For example, meniscal injury, especially those on medial side, occur as a result of torsion injury that combines compression and rotation. Slowly developing force tend to cause bony avulsions, where the muscle or ligament takes the bone away. The injury and the blow is so vigorous. To bony avulsions, whereas rapidly developing forces tend to tear ligament. In young children, injury to the growth plate or physis may occur instead of injury to the ligament. So these were some very important question which is being asked in the first term, which is being known as the mechanism of injury. Examiner should know that how the injury was happened and what was the mechanism of injury. Then the next question has been asked, that has the knee been injured before, or do it may be feeling any weakness or something. So it is very important to know that the patient injury or the athlete injury, the injury has been, the part has been otherwise been injured earlier or not. So this is very important to ask from the patient. Third is that is a patient feeling any disability, what is the patient able or unable to do functionally. Is there is any disability on running, cutting, pointing, pivoting, twisting, climbing or descending stairs. So positive responses to these questions should give a alert to examiner to instability caused by some injured ligament, muscle dysfunction, joint articular problem or meniscus problem. Then the fourth question should be, is there is any click or was there a pop sound when the injury occurred? A distinct pop may indicate an anterior ligament tear or osteochondral fracture, and popping on the lateral aspect of the knee may be due to popliteus tendon snapping over the lateral femoral anterior posterior tubercle within 2 cm of the muscle. So these popping and clicking sound may be indicated as any injury in knee or something like that. Then the fifth question should be, that did the injury occur to deceleration force or acceleration force, or the patient was in a constant speed? So basically acceleration and twisting injuries may involve the meniscus, and deceleration injuries often involve the cruciate ligament. It can be ACL, which is anterior cruciate, and PCL, posterior cruciate ligaments. and constant speed with cutting may involve the anterior cruciate ligament. Then the sixth question will be, is there is any pain? What type of pain was there? It was diffuse or aching, or there was a retropatellar pain. So basically the aching pain indicates any degeneration, like osteoarthritis condition or any other degenerative condition which indicates there are degeneration in the bone or in the joint, and sharp indicate there is some mechanical problem. Then there has to be, do pain varies with any kind of activity, and there is any increase or decrease in pain relation to any activity. And then eighth question should be, does the knee give away? And the knee give away basically indicates that there is a kind of instability. So instability in the knee can be due to meniscus pathology and patellar subluxation, if present when rotation or stopping is involved. Undisplaced osteochondritis dissection, patellofemoral syndrome, plica, or loose body. Giving away when walking uphill or downhill is more likely the result of retropatellar lesion. If the patient complains that patella slips out of the place, it may be because of patella subluxation or a pathological plica. Then the ninth question should be, has the knee ever logged? So true locking of the knee is rare. Loose bodies, like sometimes due to degeneration, the joint and the bones body became very very loose. Their outer area started breaking into loose bodies. So these loose body may cause recurrent locking, and locking must be differentiated from catching, which is momentary locking or giving away as a result of reflex, inhibition or pain. Locking in the knee usually means that the knee cannot fully extend with flexion, often being normal, or it is related to meniscus pathology. Then on the movement, then the 10th question should be, is the joint swollen? So does the swelling occur with activity or several hours after activity? And does the joint feel tight at rest? Swelling with activity may be caused by instability, and instability could be due to ligament or something, and some other element and some other condition or some other thing which is influencing the instability. And tightness at rest may be caused by arthritic changes or patellofemoral dysfunction. Is the swelling recurrent? You should ask the patient that swelling comes or go, or it is recurring with the weather change or with some activity, and it keeps on coming and going. So if so, what activity caused it? Swelling with pivoting or twisting may be result of meniscus problem or instability at the biofemoral joint. So recurrent swelling caused by climbing or descending slope or stairs may be related to patellofemoral dysfunction. Often there is no swelling in the knee after severe injury because the fluid extravasates into soft tissue surrounding the joint. So these are the general swelling is indication that when there is any injury happened, and if there is any kind of condition happened, so swelling is even a sign that there is something wrong. So swelling is a kind of alarm also to the patient, and from the body it is alarm that there is something wrong and it should be diagnosed. Then there should be the next question should be that how is the gait? Is the gait normal or not? Then there should this question has to be into the observation. But you should ask the patient that are you able to bear full weight, and due to pain sometimes patient doesn't put the entire weight on the affected side. So you must ask the patient that are you able to put entire weight on the affected side or not. And then the last question should be the type of shoe patient wear. And why it is important? Because shoes with negative heels, example earth shoes, can increase the incidence of patellofemoral syndrome. Why it is important? Because sometimes it has been a biomechanical thing valid that if there is any misalignment in toe or a feet because of shoe wear may lead to some condition in knee and may lead to pain, instability, swelling, less movement. These are all being, you know, the secondary thing, but the primary should be the examiner must ask patient that what is your shoe wear. So this was the part of, and if these, all these questions are under the patient history, and one examiner should ask all these questions to the patient very thoroughly, because these are the only questions which examiner, you know, depend their treatment. So let's see. So after patient history, the examiner should come on observation. So with observation, first there should be the anterior view standing. Now in anterior view standing, the patient, you know, see two conditions or two misalignment which happened mostly in knee. One is genu varum. Now varum is like, there are so many there were times like people get confused what is like how we remember the varum and valgum. So varum basically known as bow legs, where, you know, there is an increase in the angle of legs. So genu varum is that condition, and it is also known as bow legs. So but in children's, the genu varum is very normal in 18 to 19 month, when a child is in this kind of age, which is in 18 to 19 month, and after this it gets straightened up. So it is normal in children, but if, you know, it extended after this month or after this specific age in child, so there must be some condition which is occurring, so it should be referred to a doctor or a physiotherapist. Then the next condition should be view in adults, that is genu valgum, which is also known as knock knees. So in child it is normal from 3 to 4 years, like a child is around 3 to 4 years of age, so it is normal in them, and then, you know, it gets straightened up. But in adult it is not normal, it is an abnormal condition which has been view in anterior view standing. So this will help, like this is the first part of observation. Then examiner should view the patient in lateral view standing. So here patient, you know, examiner see that if there is hyperextended knee, if there is patella alta, which is higher patella than normal, what is the position of patella due to some mechanical injury or due to some abnormal mechanism, the patella gets higher from their position, which is known as patella alta. Then the third is patella baja or patella infera, which is, you know, lower down of patella from their normal position. The third view should be the posterior view standing. So abnormal swelling such as popliteal cyst, which is also known as Baker's cyst, and which happened due to herniation of synovial tissues, and which, if this happened due to weakening in the posterior capsule wall. So this basically, you know, gives a examiner idea if there is some sort of cyst or especially a Baker cyst. So the posterior view standing will give and some alert on it. Then the fourth will be the anterior lateral view in sitting. Now all these positions and all this view were in standing, but this has to be in sitting, which indicates that any bony enlargements are not there. There should not be any tibial torsion. There should not be any femur torsion. So that this will help, you know, when the patient is sitting. So this all will help that how the position is, you know, working, and if there is any more excessive or lower torsion of femur or tibia is going to, you know, if these things are going to influence any condition. And then it comes on to gait. Any difference in stride length, cadence, and, you know, any angular displacement if there is, because sometimes happen there are so many condition where, you know, patient gait changes because of pain and because of compensatory changes occurs due to, because there is an, you know, the protective mechanism, patient often doesn't want to lead their affected part on, and if there is an affected part, so patient doesn't want to keep the weight on it. So rather than putting excessive weight and putting a weight on it as normal they used to do it, they start putting they start doing in compensatory changes where they put excessive weight on the dominant side, which is non-affected, non-painful. So this has to be observed, that you know, when the patient walks into the clinic or into the hospital, examiner should observe the gait with the gait patient is walking, because all these element of gait is if it is, you know, abnormal or increase or decrease, then it also there has to be some condition through which it is, you know, going to be. So this was the observation part. Now after patient's history observation, now there is a time where the examiner do the examination. So in examination, first of all, patient go with the active movement. Now active movement is known as what the patient does it on their own. So in active movement, examiner will take care that excursion of patella. It tracks like the patella is moving freely upward, downward, laterally, medially, smoothly without any pain. So that has to be checked. Then the range of motion is being checked, that there is no pain-free range of motion, and there is like flexion, extension, and you know, every movement should be checked in this examination in active movement. And when and if there is any pain, so like how is the pain, and you know, where the patient is having pain, and what is the movement which is being painful. And then after that, what appear to be the limiting to the movement, what is, you know, there is a limitation in any movement, then the active range of motion may be done, then examiner moves on to the passive movement. So these should be, you know, the active movement should be done without any pain, any limitation. Then when this thing has been done, the patient, then examiner moves to the passive movement, which if active range of movement is full, then over pressure may be applied very gently to the movement, and to be checked that there is any pain or not. And after passive movements, if all these two movements are done, then the examiner goes on to the resisted isometric movement, which has been done to test the muscle, that muscles are working properly or not, in which the movements has been done like flexion of knee, extension of knee, ankle plantar flexion, and ankle dorsiflexion. So these 3-4 movements have been done and to be tested resisted isometric movement, like our isometric muscle contraction will be done to assess the range of movement in all these positions. So after these 3 movements, then the last examination is the functional test. Now this is specifically for the athletes who've been, you know, overcome from the injury, and we have to take them to the rehabilitation process in which they've been trained with this specific sport. So examiner, after performing these 3 test, which has been active movement, passive movement, and resisted isometric active movement, and then the examiner comes on to the functional assessment, because this tells the patient that now what kind of exercise and how much the athlete has been, you know, recovered. So first is single leg hop 4 times, like single leg with the athlete will be asked, or the patient will be asked to do a single leg hop test. And then there will be a modification in this hopping, which will be triple hop test, crossover hop test, agility hop test, and last will be the stance hop test. So these are the functional tests which one examiner would perform on an injured or a overcome injury athlete, and this will determine that how the athlete has been now recovered, and what are the elements which still has to be strengthened and to be highlighted on. So in single leg hop, for the time the patient will be, when like in this test, the patient is assessed for the time taken to hop 6 meter on one leg. The good leg is tested first, followed by the injured leg. Now the next will be triple hop. In this test, the patient is asked to hop as far as possible, taking 3 hops The distance for the good leg is compared with that for the injured leg. Now the next one will be the crossover hop. A straight line is marked on the floor. The patient is asked to take 3 consecutive hop on one foot, crossing over the straight line each time. The good limb is tested, followed by the injured limb, and the average distance attained with each leg are compared. So this was the these were the process of these hop tests. Now the next will be the agility hop. This hop test requires a space of 30 meter. Full assessment, the therapist comes on to the another important element, which is being special test. And these special tests differentiate between one condition to another condition and to give a clarification to a therapist to plan and to go on to a prognosis of a condition. And if this DD, which has been differential diagnosis, done properly, will give a good reflection on a treatment protocol and indeed gives a good result to a patient or an athlete in which form you have been planned their treatment. So the first test will be about the meniscus lesions. So if there is any meniscus lesion or a meniscus injury, the first test will be the McMurray test. Second will be the Apley's test, and third will be the Bounce-Home test. So these 3 tests will be performed to see the positive or the negative effect, negative or positive condition if there is any meniscus lesion. So these tests will be going to indicate that there will be any meniscus lesion to a patient. And if now next will be the plica lesion. So plica lesion indicate and to, you know, differentiate between all the conditions other than that, we will perform these 3 tests. The first will be the medial patellar plica lesion test, Slutter test, and Hongston test. So these 3 tests will be done to differentiate that if there is any plica lesion or not. Then other than that, for swelling, we will see that there is any swelling. So how to, you know, differentiate that, there will be the 3 tests here as well. First will be the brush test, then there will be an indentation test, then there will be a patellar test. So these 3 tests will, you know, help an examiner to see that there is swelling and, you know, how this swelling will be differentiated from other conditions. Then the condition comes patellofemoral syndrome. So now this condition gives very similar symptoms and signs like an osteoarthritis and other conditions also. So but it is very important for examiner to see that patellofemoral syndrome is there or it has been osteoarthritis. So see that difference and, you know, come on to a correct prognosis. One should done a Clerk sign test and McConnell test. So these 2 tests will be done to see that there is this condition which is known as patellofemoral syndrome is present or not. Then for quadricep pull, examiner will perform 2 tests, which will be in Q angle, which is quadricep angle, and tubercle sulcus angle. These 2 tests will be performed to see that there is quadricep pull or quadricep muscle weakening is present or not. Then if there is any condition to a patient which is osteochondritis decision, then Wilson test will be performed. Patellar instability, to check the patellar instability, the apprehension test will be checked. Instability band, iliotibial band friction syndrome, ITBFS, noble comprehension test will be performed. Then the last will be the leg length test. So if there is any discrepancy or there is any changes in leg length, sometimes what happen is that if there is a excessive major vigorous pull from the muscles, then it tends to create an LLD, which is leg length dyspareunia. So to conclude that if there is any LLD present in a patient due to any condition, the leg length test is being performed. So these are very important tests, special tests performed by an examiner, and examiner should be expert and, you know, very seeking and very correct correctly done these kind of tests, so that in future there should be an exact protocol being followed for an exact condition. So thank you so much. This was a kind of video which will help many physiotherapist students and you know the new physiotherapists who have been interning these days in an hospital. So this will be very easy information for them, and this will help you to even make a correct treatment protocol and have a correct information about any condition. Thank you so much.